Is it training?
Oh, my God.
Is that the October?
Yeah.
I mean, I'm just. You know what, a job was a big thing.
morning.
Good morning.
Please rise. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose image we are made and who claims us and calls us beloved. Amen. Let us take a moment for silent prayer and confession of our sins. Holy One, we confess that we are not awake for you. We are not faithful in using your gifts. We forget the least of our siblings. We do not see your beautiful image in one another. We're infected by sin that divides your beloved community. Open our hearts to your coming. Open our eyes to see you and our neighbor. Open our hands to serve your creation. Amen. Beloved, we are God's children, and Jesus, our beloved, opens the door for us. Through Jesus, your sins are forgiven, and by Jesus, you are welcome. In Jesus, you are called to rejoice. Let us live in the promises prepared for us from the foundation of the world. Amen. Let us pray. O God, of justice and love, you illumine our way through life with words of your Son. Give us the light we need and awaken us to the needs of others. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated. Our psalm is Psalm 70. Be pleased, O God, to deliver me. Let those be put to shame and confusion who seek my life.
Let those be turned back and brought to dishonor.
Let those who say, aha, aha, turn back because of their shame. Okay? Let all who seek you rejoice and be glad in you.
Let those who love your salvation say evermore, God is great.
When I am poor and needy, hasten to me, O God.
You are my help and my deliverer. O Lord, do not delay.
The first reading for today comes from Amos chapter 5, verses 18 through 24. In the days of Amos, people thought that the day of the Lord would be a time of great victory. But Amos announced that it would be a day of darkness, not light. He said, liturgy is no substitute for obedience. The Lord demands justice and righteousness in the community. The reading begins. Alas for you who desire the day of the Lord. Why do you want the day of the Lord? It is darkness, not light, as if someone fled from a lion and was met by a bear. Or went into the house and rested a hand against the wall and was bitten by a snake. Is not the day of the Lord darkness, not light, and gloom with no brightness in it? I hate, I despise your festivals, and I take no delight in your solemn assemblies. Even though you offer me your burnt offerings and grain offerings, I will not accept them. And the offerings of well-being of your fatted animals, I will not look upon. Take away from me the noise of your songs. I will not listen to the melody of your harps, but let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. The word of our Lord.
Thanks be to God. A
little change in the program. I'm doing a second reading right now, which comes from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 through 18. Some of the Thessalonians are worried that dead Christians will be excluded from the resurrection to eternal life when Christ comes again. Paul reassures them with the word of hope that all Christians, living or dead, will be raised into everlasting life with Christ. The reading begins. We do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who have died, so that you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have died. For this we declare to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will by no means precede those who have died. For the Lord himself, with a cry of command, with archangel's call, and with the sound of God's trumpet, will descend from heaven, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught in the clouds, together with them to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise for the gospel.
No.
Oh. See, you change things up on me. And I struggle. Sorry about that.
Who was coming as all the hosts of heaven? Who was coming?
tells a parable about his own second coming, emphasizing the need for readiness at all times. The gospel reads, "Then the kingdom of heaven will be like this. 10 bridesmaids took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. When the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them, but the wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, all became drowsy and slept. But at midnight there was a shout, 'Look, here is the bridegroom, come out to meet him.' Then all those bridesmaids got up, trimmed their lamps. The foolish said to the wise, 'Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out.' But the wise replied, 'No, there will not be enough for you and for us. You had better go to the dealers and buy some for yourselves.' And while they went to buy it, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went with him into the wedding banquet. The door was shut. Later, the other bridesmaids came also, saying, 'Lord, open to us.' But he replied, 'Truly I tell you, I do not know you. Keep awake, therefore, for you do not know the day nor the hour.'" The gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. Friends in Christ, grace to you and peace from God, our Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious God, you lead us through life, giving us what we need each day. Bless us with your presence today. Help us to know your will and lead us as we live out our lives. Give us the oil we need for our lamps. Fill us with your Holy Spirit. Now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our Rock and our Redeemer. Amen. There's something that bothers me about this gospel parable, this wedding feast. Why didn't those 5 young women that had the extra oil share with the ones that ran out, that didn't bring extra? We have to ask that question because it's ringing in my head. Why didn't they? It might be helpful to look at the wedding customs of Jesus' time. Weddings back then were huge celebrations that lasted a whole week. The high point involved the coming of the bridegroom to the bride's parents' home to take her to their new house. The bride had chosen 10 of her best friends as the bridesmaids, and they were to wait for the groom to arrive at the bride's parents' house. And then the groom would gather all of them, and they would have a procession all the way to their new home. Now, here's an example for you of what a lamp would look like back in Jesus' day. It's pretty small, and I don't know if this was the exact size of it all, but I kind of did a little doctoring to it, and we'll turn it on here. You can turn on the light. And so there's not a lot of light to come from. They're pretty small. So I can't imagine them lasting hours and hours just burning like this. And you would need to have an extra lamp along, extra oil along for your lamp, I would think. So these bridesmaids didn't have enough, half of them. And the coming of the bridegroom was to be secret. It was to be a surprise for the weddings and the attendants. And when they all entered their new home, the door was shut. It was barred, and then the festivities began. Latecomers were not admitted. It was considered an insult for people to arrive late. And so those who arrived with the procession were greeted and welcomed into this great banquet, but the others were not. There was no honeymoon in those days. The entire first week was spent in the new home enjoying the wedding feast. Now, the rub in this parable for me that Jesus tells is that these five bridesmaids had enough oil only for a very short time. It was running out because the bridegroom was delayed. When the bridegroom did arrive, they woke and they got ready for the procession. Those who didn't think to bring any extra oil ran out, so they went to purchase more oil. They arrived late, and of course they weren't admitted. So, if the others knew this was going to happen, why didn't they share with those who ran out? Jesus is saying here that it is of ultimate importance for those who follow him to be ready at all times for his coming. We don't know, we can't predict when the coming of our Lord will be, but we have to be ready. Sometimes it's just not possible to fill someone else's lamp. As a young pastor in my first parish, there were quite a few times when I had to rush out to meet with a grieving family. Some of them were people with a strong faith, active people in the church, and they had a great faith. Others were not involved with the church, and maybe a church member had called or a neighbor had called and asked if I would come out to the family to visit with them. One of the most difficult questions that I would be asked at that time was why? Why did God do this to me? Why did my loved one have to leave? And leave me all alone? Those times of raw grief were not the times to start making theological points and describe the nature of sin in a broken world. It wasn't the time to fill someone else's lamp with oil. It would not have been heard or understood as helpful. There just was time to comfort and to give them reassurance, to let them know that you cared and that you would help them through this time. Those who are regular in worship may find that their time in church can help them prepare for tragedies and difficult life events just by being around other Christians. We can find that having an active faith and a growing faith life gives us a firm foundation to weather out those storms of life. It's like coming and putting oil in our lamps. I'm going to blow this up now. Maybe. You burned it. Our congregation has lost a dear member this past week, and many of us have lost a good friend in Carol Willie. Some of you that I have talked with say that you just can't stop thinking about her sudden death and what that means for Dave and the family. Carol was so active in worship, in women's activities such as the Bible studies, the welcome studies, and the fellowship activities. And maybe Carol and Dave as well were filling their proverbial lamps for this unknown future. An article in a ministry journal that I was reading said, preparation for marriage begins in infancy and carries on throughout life. In all of the ways that we learn to be faithful people, faithful husbands and and wives, and we learn from those that have gone before us. And we get our proverbial lamps filled with oil when we pick up all these little pieces along the way. And that's where I think this text really speaks to us. It's a hard thing to always be ready. It's a hard thing to wait 2,000 years and expect to be ready for the Lord when he returns. Who can possibly be alert and keep on their toes for that long? It's one thing to prepare for something that we know is right around the bend, such as winter. When fall arrives and the leaves start turning, the air gets fresher and colder, and the days get shorter, we know that it's time to get ready for winter. We reluctantly take our boats and docks and lifts and things out of the lake. We put away the picnic tables and the lawn chairs and those things. We pick up the leaves and we get our snow blowers ready. Yet, as we go forward in faith, and as we step into the unknown each day, we find ways to fill our lamps with oil as we go. We grow in faith, which gives us courage and hope in times of despair and loss. We find comfort in Christ's death and resurrection, knowing that the promise of new life awaits us. We keep refilling our lamps, moving forward with Jesus leading the way. I've heard so many people who face tragedy or deep sorrow say that if it were not for their strong faith in Jesus, they wouldn't have any hope for the future. I'm always amazed when I hear of people surviving for long periods of time in a difficult situation, like stranded on a mountain or following a car accident or such other calamities. I think of the story of a young man who was on a day hike in the mountains and slipped on a sheet of ice, breaking his ankle. He survived for days by drinking water from a mountain stream, eating bugs and berries because of his earlier survival training. He was prepared to meet the challenges that he faced, and he made the best of them. Prayer, worship, and scripture reading give these survivors a strong base upon which they can rebuild their lives. The faith helps sustain them and prepares them to face challenges that lie ahead. This has also been my experience in ministering with people who have serious illnesses or have lost a loved one to death. Their faith gives them the hope and the strength to carry on, to meet those challenges. Being prepared for the return of our Lord is deeply rooted in the presence of Christ in our daily lives. It's living each day with the Lord, spending time with him, in prayer, reading his word, living life to the fullest as his servants here and now. Being prepared for Christ is knowing deep in our hearts that he has first come to us, saved us with his precious body and blood, and renews us each day in our baptisms, in the fellowship of other Christians. Being prepared is letting the Holy Spirit guide us each day, opening ourselves up to the ways that Christ calls us to serve, to love his people. It's filling our lamps with oil for the great feast in the kingdom of heaven. We're not waiting for tomorrow to come. We're his children now, and we are in his care and keeping until that glorious day, when he returns to bring us all to our heavenly home, whenever that day shall come for us. You reign in our hearts and lives as our God and Father. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for Dave and the Willie family as they prepare for Carol's service this afternoon. Keep them in your love, and in the days and months ahead, fill them with your presence. Remind them the promise of life that awaits. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear
our prayer. God of healing and hope, we pray for those who are dealing with health concerns and struggling with the coronavirus. Bless those who are recovering from illness or surgery. Bring healing to those facing health and life crises, and give hope to all. We remember especially today Morgan Sandy, Luann Jacobson, Mark Wing, Verl Blaha, Gary Selvar, Jim Eastman, Susan Hodder, Mary Weber, Kurt Thorson, Tanya Hinch, Harry Weeks, and all those that we name in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy. We remember our veterans who have served our country. Bless them with the respect and the thanks they deserve for the sacrifices they have made for us all. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us pray our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. We're going to do another little switcheroo in the service, and we'll have the song Glorious Day at this time.
When heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The Word became flesh and the Lord shined upon us, his glory revealed. Thank you.
Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. Go in peace, serve the Lord.